This week on Wealth Track, two retirement experts, Kiplinger's Kim Lankford and New York Life's Chris Blunt, identify sources of guaranteed income for life to help retirees avoid running out of money. That's next on Consuelo Mack Wealth Track.
New York Life, along with Mainstay's family of mutual funds, offers investment and retirement solutions so you can help your clients keep good going.
Additional funding provided by Loomis Sayles, investors seeking exceptional opportunities globally. Thornburg Investment Management, active management, global perspective. Rosalind P. Walter, and the Fairholm Foundation.
Hello and welcome to this edition of Wealth Track. I'm Consuelo Mack. How to pay for retirement remains one of the greatest financial challenges for Americans. And the baby boom generation is staring it in the face. Of the estimated 76 million of us born between 1946 and 1965, two-thirds or 40 million are already 65 or older. Yet only one in four boomers expect significant income from an employer-provided pension. Aside from Social Security, most boomers are on their own. And according to the sixth annual report on retirement preparedness by the Insured Retirement Institute, many boomers are woefully unprepared and their situation has only gotten worse over the last 5 years. Less than half, approximately 35 million of them, lack any retirement savings today. 59% of them cite Social Security as a major source of retirement income, up from 42% 5 years ago. Only 24% of boomers are highly confident they will have enough savings to last throughout retirement, down from 36%. And less than 40% have tried to figure out how much they need to have saved for retirement, and a third of them did not include health care costs in their calculations. But there is good news for boomers as well. Working with a financial advisor can make a huge difference in financial well-being. At least 9 in 10 boomers who work with a financial advisor have retirement savings, and more than 8 in 10 who work with financial professionals believe they are better prepared for retirement. Well, this week we are discussing how to increase streams of income later in life with two retirement pros who were with us 5 years ago to explore guaranteed income producing strategies. And we asked them back to find out what the best options are now. Kim Lankford is an award-winning personal finance journalist, contributing editor and columnist for Kiplinger's Personal Finance magazine, an acknowledged expert on insurance, and author of several books, including The Insurance Maze, How to Save Money on Insurance and Still Get the Coverage You Need. Christopher Blunt is president of the Investments Group at New York Life, where he oversees its $500 billion asset management business, as well as its annuities divisions. When Blunt was on last, he was head of the Retirement Income Security Group at New York Life. New York Life is a WealthTrack sponsor, but Blunt is here on his own merit as an acknowledged pro in the retirement field. He started out as a financial advisor and since then has spent most of his career advising financial planners on retirement solutions for their clients. I began the interview asking them for an update, their assessment of the state of retirees 5 years later.
Well, I think retirees know how difficult it is going to be to prepare for retirement. They realize that many of them don't have a pension. Social Security is only going to cover part of their expenses. And that they, in addition to just their living expenses, the cost of health care is increasing, and so many of them are having to live through long-term care. Many of them are helping their parents deal with long-term care expenses and are really worried about what they're going to do themselves. So a lot of them are more aware that they need to plan, but it's very intimidating to figure out what to do.
Right. Chris, what's your sense of the financial health of retirees 5 years, later than the last time we talked?
Sure. I think the biggest change is just the level of interest rates. We've seen interest rates plummet. And so a lot of financial advisors are struggling dealing with their clients and how do you generate reliable income in an environment where there's no yield?
What are the biggest financial challenges? If you were to, you know, to rank them, what's the number one or two biggest financial challenges that retirees are facing today?
Well, I think the most popular questions I get from readers have to do with healthcare, whether it's just filling in the gaps from Medicare, dealing with the system. A lot of them are about to retire. So many of them are turning 65 and just wondering, do I even sign up for Medicare now? How much do I need to set aside? There's a study that says that you need to have about $240,000, a couple that retires this year, a 65-year-old couple, to cover their out-of-pocket healthcare expenses in retirement. And that's not even counting potential long-term care expenses. And that's with Medicare. So a lot of people just need to factor in this much larger number into their retirement planning than they were originally expecting.
Right. And Chris, what are you finding that you advise, you know, financial advisors all the time? What are they telling you they're hearing from their clients as to what the biggest financial challenges that their clients are facing?
Yeah, it's a lot of the same issues. It's how do you plan for retirement that could be longer than the period with which you worked? You've seen the statistics. There's a 1 in 4 chance that one member of a couple will live to be the age of 99. So if you retire at 65, that means the reality is you could be living in retirement longer than you actually worked. And so the real issue is, how do you provide for income streams that people can't outlive? But at the same time, they need growth as well, because they've got to keep pace with inflation. Because even at 2%, inflation can destroy a portfolio if you're talking 30 or 40 years.
What are you advising them for solutions?
Yeah, and I think you hit the key word, Consuelo, and that's solutions. You know, the days of recommending a singular product that's going to be the answer to all of your financial issues in retirement are long gone. So that's my first bit of advice for folks is, you need to work with someone who looks at the whole picture, looks at sources of guaranteed income, which today there are really only three left. There's Social Security, there's pensions, and then there are things like income annuities, which will provide people with a lifetime stream of income.
Right.
But at the same time, you got to then make sure that that works holistically with your investment portfolio.
So it's a very important to get the total picture now. It's not, as you said, it's not just a one or two product solution.
Absolutely.
Kim, what do you tell your readers when they do say, look, long-term care is just going to eat me alive? So what are some of the solutions to cope with those problems?
Well, first of all, you just need to be aware of the potential costs. I mean, it can cost $80,000 to $90,000 a year for long-term care if you're in a nursing home, maybe a little less if you have assisted living. And so many people want to have home care, which actually, if you need round-the-clock care, can cost a lot more. So be aware of what those costs are, and you need to factor that into your retirement plan. Now, a lot of people have bought long-term care insurance in the past, and many times when it first came out, they would look at the potential costs of long-term care and buy a policy that would cover all those expenses.
Then, when they first bought the policy.
Right.
Right. So the expenses now have gone up tremendously, right?
The expenses have gone up tremendously, and the policies are a lot more expensive than they had been in the past. So many people now are doing a compromise. They're figuring out how much of those potential costs they could cover through their own savings and income, some of those income streams like Chris talked about, and also then maybe buying a long-term care insurance policy to fill in that gap, maybe cover maybe half of the potential costs or some other way. There's many other ways to use life insurance and other products, annuities that can help fill in that gap and provide an extra income stream when you really need that money for long-term care. Because they're seeing this with their parents. They're seeing their parents' portfolios just getting eaten up by this long-term care expenses. And they know they might have a few decades before this might happen to them, but they need to be prepared.
You know, the initial thing that we had talked about 5 years ago, Kristen, that you mentioned as well, is that there really are only three sources of income streams. And one is Social Security. And the other one, as you mentioned, is pensions. And then there are these guaranteed, you know, insurance products, the annuities. What are you telling financial advisors as to, you know, how you kind of coordinate those three income streams? What are you telling them?
The reality is, if you have expenses that are going to last your whole lifetime, ideally you want to match as much of that up as you can with income that you won't outlive as well. Back to the point of one out of, you know, four chance that one of you is going to live to be 99 years old.
Right.
You need some stream of guaranteed lifetime income. So you would start with Social Security. You would look at, are you fortunate enough to have a pension? Many people don't have any pension income today. And then what is that gap to, at a minimum, cover your basic expenses? Healthcare is a big one. You know you're going to need some amount of money for as long as you live for healthcare. But there's others. There's housing. There's taxes. There's expenses that you know you're going to have forever. Can you line as much of that up as possible with a guaranteed lifetime income stream? And that's how people are using things like income annuities or deferred income annuities, where you might say, here's a chunk of money, I'm going to defer it until I'm, say, 65 or 70, then I want a pension-like income stream to kick in. But it's equally important, people need growth as well, and that's back to the inflation point. You know, the only proven vehicle that can keep pace with inflation over time has been in equities, and in particularly from things like dividend paying stocks. So it's really getting that formula right. So depending on what firm and your situation and the models that they'll use, they'll often suggest somewhere between 15 and 30% of your income be annuitized as part of your portfolio.
Right. And so annuitized, again, that would be with Social Security would be part of that pool,
correct,
right? And then with these, the fixed immediate annuity or the deferred income annuities.
To
fill that gap. What's your point of view as a journalist, Kim, about the annuity portion of this? And the fixed income annuities or the deferred income annuities?
Well, I've been really interested in the deferred income annuities. And that actually has really helped solve the long-term care problem. A lot of people worry about paying premiums for years and years and years for long-term care, and they may not end up needing it. And a deferred income annuity can provide them with income maybe when they're 75, 80 or so, when they're more likely to need care, but they don't need to use that for care. So they know that that money's gonna come in at the time when they may need it, but they have whatever they need it for, because even if they don't need long-term care, if they're still alive and they're healthy at that point, they're going to need some extra income. So I've really been interested in that product.
Right. And when do you buy a deferred income annuity? I mean, is there a magic age when you should buy it?
I think a lot of people are buying them in their 60s or so. Maybe as they're starting to retire, rolling money over from their retirement plan.
Right.
Or maybe even before then, and really starting to focus on, okay, I need to know that I have money available after this point, and then I can manage my portfolio from 65 to 80. It gives me a start and end date for the rest of the money. And another thing, it's the new tax law was passed that really helps these. It's called Qualified Longevity Annuity Contracts, QLACs. And it means that people can defer money that was in IRAs and 401ks even past age 70 without having to worry about minimum required distributions.
Right. Distribution.
Which had been really holding people back from being able to make the most of these, because a lot of their money is in their retirement plans. And so you can take up to $125,000 from your IRAs, or up to 25%, and put it in one of these special annuities, and that money then does not have to be subject to the required minimum distribution. So that also helps your tax bills, as you reach age 70. And then you pay the taxes on the money when you finally get it, which could be, 10, 15 years after that.
Yeah, I would say this has been huge. This has been,
right.
I think even we were surprised by the interest from clients and financial advisors and what are known as QLAC annuities. The other way that people are using deferred income annuities, Consuelo, is sometimes they will start the income a bit earlier to allow them to delay taking Social Security. There's been a lot written about the fact of the great benefits if you can delay taking your Social Security.
Right, until 70, and later you can delay
absolutely.
It, the more you
so
get.
Our typical buyer has actually been in their mid-50s to early 60s to try to create a future income stream to allow them to hold off, so to speak, turning on the Social Security spigot.
But in this low interest rate environment, what kind of returns would you be getting from a deferred income annuity, for instance?
I think people are surprised by the payout rates that you can get. And the reason for that is, if you're going to hand the insurance company a chunk of money, defer it for 5, 7, maybe even 10 years, and then have that paid out to you over 20 years.
Right.
The insurance company is allowed to invest very, very long. So it's really not dependent on short-term interest rates.
Right.
I saw a statistic that the 10-year treasury yield in the last, 5 years has come down by 26%. The payout on income annuities during that period only came down about 7%, because it's really tied to long-term interest rates. So it allows you to invest way out in a format that the average individual investor would not be comfortable investing.
But Kim, I know that there are some very vocal critics out there who I hear them advertising all the time, and it's never buy an annuity. What's your sense of the skepticism towards annuities, even the most simple, the simpler ones that we're talking about?
Well, and I think that's the problem, is so many different things are called annuities.
Right.
There are some annuities that are like investments, variable annuities, and it's just a way to defer income taxes on money that you invest in mutual fund-like accounts. And some of them do have a guaranteed income stream. But the other type of annuity that the academics have loved and more financial planners like are the ones that do provide that guaranteed lifetime income. I think that you don't hear as many criticisms about that, other than the fact that it is low interest rates. So the immediate annuities, the payout rates are lower than they had been when interest rates were higher. But I think that it's two very different types of annuities. One more of an investment, but the one that's the lifetime income stream, like Chris said, there really is very little way to get a guaranteed, no other way to get a guaranteed lifetime income stream other than that.
You had some thoughts about the criticisms as well, right, Chris?
Absolutely. I would say, once again, it's too broad of an umbrella because there's so many different types of annuities. But I think you've seen the media, you've even seen the government, encouraging annuitization, which was sort of the original form of what an annuity was. But, let's also keep in mind there's psychological benefits. And in fact, we hear from financial advisors that clients who had some guaranteed minimum floor of income in retirement, much less likely to panic during the market disruptions of 2008 or 2009. So there's the math behind it, but we also shouldn't lose sight of the psychology of knowing, particularly when you're in retirement, that there's some pension-like stream of income that frankly will be there no matter what happens in the market.
Right, the psychological hurdle that one has to cross in order to give an insurance company a large sum of money, knowing, of course, my luck, this is what people have told me, I'm going to be hit by a bus the minute I write the check to the insurance company. So how do you overcome that objection and that issue?
Sure, I'd say a couple of things. One, the real power of the product is risk pooling, because the reason it's got that high payout is you are benefiting from people who pass away prematurely. So it's a little bit of which risk do you want to take off the table. But if the one you're most worried about is outliving your income, you have to take advantage of the risk pooling. Now, having said that, there are features on these contracts like return of premium, guaranteeing you that if you die in those early years, which statistically don't happen very often, that at a minimum you'll get your premiums back. It doesn't lower the payout rate that much, but it helps a little bit with that. I don't want the insurance company to win out type of thing.
Right.
And I also think what Chris said at the beginning about putting it all into context really helps too. I mean, you really just want this guaranteed income to cover your guaranteed expenses, those expenses you know are coming all the time.
Right.
And you first start with, do I have a pension? And then how much will I get from Social Security? Those are all things that can cover some of those guaranteed expenses. And then just get an annuity to fill in the gap if you want to have that guaranteed income for your life.
So talk to us, Kim, about long-term, care. And the kinds of planning that we should be doing to take care of long-term care expenses, which a mutual friend of Kim's and my called us and said, look, my long-term care insurance premium just went up 60%. What do I do?
Right. And the worst thing you could do at that point is drop the policy entirely because you've been paying for years and years and years, and you're getting closer to the age where you may end up needing it.
Right.
But usually the insurance companies give you a few options, and you really need to consider those. One of the key things that they may offer is to reduce your inflation protection from 5%, which was the standard back several years ago, to maybe about 3%. And what you need to do in that case is find out how much you've amassed, how much your benefits have grown through the years, and make sure that those that you've paid for through the years would still be locked in. And then consider, well, maybe, from this point on, maybe it doesn't have to grow quite as much, and maybe it could grow at 3% instead. Another key thing people have been doing is, instead of having lifetime benefits, which has been extraordinarily expensive for the insurance companies, some of them are reducing that to 5 years or 3 years. Now, if you can afford lifetime benefits, you need to weigh that, because that could be very valuable if you do end up having something like Alzheimer's that lasts for a very long time. But if you really need to reduce the premiums, think about stepping back to maybe 5 years, or a lot of people do 3 years, because that's about the average need that people have.
No, I was going to ask, what is the average need? Is it about 3 years?
It's a little less than 3 years.
Right.
Yeah, this is one of those topics, too, we often hear from folks, nursing homes. I'll never go into nursing homes. Well, the reality is 70% of us will need some form of long-term care.
Yes.
And I actually view it as anti-nursing home insurance. In other words, it wouldn't be nice to have a pot of money where you say, I'd like to have care at home as long as possible so I can avoid going into a nursing home.
Right.
The other thing I would say is, and Kim touched on this earlier, there's been a proliferation of different types of products. So for many people, long-term care would be the most appropriate solution. But you're now seeing things like you can put a rider on your life insurance policy where maybe for 4 or 5% an additional premium or cost, relatively reasonable cost, you can accelerate the face value of your life insurance policy.
And what does that mean to accelerate
that? Yeah, meaning you maybe have $1 million policy,
right,
and if you pay an extra 4% in premium, the insurance company will allow you to take up to $500,000 of that and use it to spend on long-term care.
Wow. Obviously, with an existing policy.
Most of these now are on new policies that you can add these riders to. But that's I put that one in the category of it's sort of a no-brainer.
Sure,
right?
Because
if you need it, it could be game-changing. And frankly, if you don't need it, you know, the cost was relatively small.
Health savings accounts, I know that you are a big proponent of them. Why? And obviously, if you're retired, there are certain age limits for health savings. Who are they appropriate for?
Well, this is where you do need to consider this in your retirement planning. Because once you are on Medicare, you can no longer make new contributions to a health savings account.
Okay, so that's something else.
But even if you just start at age 55 or start at age 50 or so, and make those contributions until you get onto Medicare, you can still get this triple tax benefit. You get pre-tax money that you can set aside or tax deductible if you're doing it on your own. Through an employer, and then it grows tax deferred, and then you can use it tax free for healthcare expenses. And a lot of people don't realize that you don't need to use that money every year. It's not like a flexible spending account through your employer where you have to use it or lose it. This is money that you can invest. Many companies are now letting you invest it in some mutual funds, and it can grow for years and years. So what I recommend to make the most of it is to maybe pay some of your regular healthcare out-of-pocket expenses with cash out of your pocket, and let that money grow tax-free in the health savings account for the future. And then it can be a great stash of money for retirement healthcare expenses too, because even though you can't make new contributions after you're on Medicare, you can use it to pay for your Medicare Part B premiums, your Medicare Part D, Medicare Advantage. You can even use a portion of it to pay for your long-term care insurance premiums. So there's so many expenses you can pay for later on, and it is this triple tax benefit that's really hard to beat.
So your investment for a long-term diversified portfolio is a health savings account.
If you qualify. And really, all you need to qualify is to have a high deductible health insurance policy. And that means that if you're an individual, it's at least $1,300 deductible or $2,600 deductible if you have a family plan. And so many more people these days have high deductible policies anyway.
Right.
Their employers are shifting to have more high deductible policies. Many are encouraging people to open HSAs or even contributing to the accounts themselves. The employer's contributing, the individual's contributing, or if you're buying your own health insurance, this is something that people have had to do for the last many years, is raise their deductibles to make it more affordable. So a lot of people have the policies that qualify them anyway,
right,
and you really should make the most of these tax benefits.
That's a great idea. What would your recommendation be for a long-term diversified portfolio?
Okay, I'm going to cheat a little bit and say I would invest in a relationship with a high-quality financial advisor. You know, the retirement income space is exponentially more complicated than the accumulation phase.
Right.
There's a lot of risks to worry about taking off the table. There's longevity, there's inflation, there's timing of the market, sequence of return risks, health insurance, we've talked about it.
So, and the designations of, you know, how do I find the right qualifications? There are certain designations, right, that you think we should have with our financial advisors?
Yeah,
is that
absolutely.
Right?
In fact, the fastest growing designation in the industry right now is something called a Retirement Income Certified Professional, or RICP.
Mm-hmm.
And that is something offered by the American College of Financial Services, and they're the largest provider of designations.
Right.
Things like Certified Financial Planner, Retirement Income Designations, Insurance Designations, etc. So I would
So that one designation means that you are basically have expertise in being a financial planner and insurance products and estate planning. Is that right? It's kind of a
correct,
very comprehensive.
And in the case of the retirement income designation, it'll go through the ins and outs of Social Security. It's an in-depth program that advisors sit through a series of courses with exams that will talk not just about, you know, ways of drawing safely retirement income and what's a safe withdrawal rate, but how these various vehicles fit together, the impact of inflation. It'll talk about Social Security, et cetera. So it's a pretty comprehensive program.
All right. It is so complicated. And thank you both so much for at least, you know, bringing me up to speed on the challenges that all of us face for retirement planning. Chris Blunt from New York Life, just lovely to have you back here.
Great.
Again.
Thank you.
And Kim Lankford from Kiplinger's. To have the two of you back here again is just great. Thanks.
Thanks.
At the close of every Wealth Track, we try to give you one suggestion to help you build and protect your wealth over the long term. This week's action point is see a financial planner to discuss guaranteed income options. Outliving your savings is the biggest financial challenge most retirees face. In addition to Social Security, there are several straightforward and simple solutions that can help you manage that uncertainty by taking advantage of the pooling mortality risks that annuities offer. Worth discussing with your financial advisor are immediate annuities that start paying out lifetime income immediately, deferred income annuities that start the payments at a specified future date, and a recent deferred income entry is the Qualified Longevity Annuity Contracts, or QLACs, which were introduced in 2014 for use in traditional IRAs, 401ks, and other approved retirement plans. QLACs are fixed income annuities that allow you to use 25% of your retirement account, or $125,000, whichever is less, to fund. They are excluded from the traditional required minimum distribution calculations at age 70 and a half, and the income payments can be deferred to age 85. QLACs also have legacy benefits, which can be left to spouse and non-spouse beneficiaries. Each one of these choices has features that can be added at extra cost, such as inflation adjustments and partial refunds. To see this program again and other WealthTrack interviews with financial thought leaders, please go to our website, WealthTrack.com. Also, keep reaching out to us on Facebook and Twitter. Thanks for watching. Have a great weekend and make the week ahead a profitable and a productive one.
New York Life, along with Mainstay's family of mutual funds, offers investment and retirement solutions so you can help your clients keep good going.
Additional funding provided by Loomis Sayles, investors seeking exceptional opportunities globally. Thornburg Investment Management, active management, global perspective. Rosalind P. Walter and the Fairholme Foundation.